Welcome back to the beautiful Highlands of Scotland, home to some amazing winter wildlife.
We're discovering how different animals make it through this unforgiving season.
It's getting colder. It was -5 here last night. How are our animals going to cope?
Get comfy on your sofa and get ready for Winter Watch. Yes, welcome to Winter Watch, and we're here at the Agersfield Centre in the Highlands of Scotland, and it's a fabulous place for us to be. Now, if you've been watching our programmes for the last couple of nights, well, let me be frank, let me be candid. You know, we've brought you the sexiest Scandinavian birds that could ever land in your garden, waxwings. We've brought you the cutest baby animals known to humankind, baby grey seals. But not only that, we've also given you mass centralisation in the ptarmigan, the world's first rodentorium, and for you connoisseurs of mustarded territoriality, a delicate little puff of pine marten urine. After this riot of zoological bravado, you probably think that we are spent, we have nothing more. But you couldn't be further from the truth, because we've got yet another fantastic programme.
We certainly have, because even though it was -5 here last night, even though it went down to -13 in Norfolk, and those wintry conditions are spreading throughout the country, making it all look rather beautiful, a lot of our wildlife is still braving the cold. And so are our camera teams to bring you some great winter wildlife stories. And it seems like lots of you have been out in the snow as well. Paul Farnfield from Coventry sent us this picture of a robin on his bird table, desperately trying to get a little bit of water from the icicle. Quite an iconic winter season photo. Thanks for that. Keep sending them in.
Now we're going to find out why our cities can become a haven for wildlife at this time of year. Extraordinary pictures.
And in our revised and all-new rodentorium, there's been a visitor that's slightly larger than the typical rodents that we see. I wonder what it could be. Of course, we'll reveal the answer to that a bit later in the programme. But we're going to start with a quiz. Take a look at this. This is a feather which I collected the other day, and I'm very, very pleased to have this feather, I can tell you. It's come from an exquisite winter visitor to the UK. And I'm wondering whether you can identify which species of bird this feather came from. If you think you know the answer, you can contact us via the website, bbc.co.uk/winterwatch, or by Twitter or on the blog as well. Let us know what you think this feather came from. And of course, a bit later on, we will reveal all. And I can tell you, it's pretty special.
You are on a bit of a rodentorium roll today, may I say,
so
Chris?
Yes.
Now, as we've been saying, it was -5 here last night. You saw on the programme last night that the loch froze over. It's frozen now. But this morning, we had a little bit of milder weather and the ice melted, giving us some fabulous beaver footage on our live cameras, all looking very pretty. What came out in the water early in the morning, which is always wonderful to see, the adult beaver Lily, that's the female, swims underneath and then goes to the middle of the loch, where we were quite surprised to learn she had a cache. Brings up an enormous twig, swims back in her mouth, and then swimming towards the lodge now, the artificial lodge that we've got the live cameras in, dives down into the opening, and then we pick her up on our other camera. There she is with the twig. She's pulling it in. Must be hard work, that. And if you listen, you can hear a little noise. That is one of the kits communicating with Lily. And if listen again, and you hear Lily gnawing. Now, that's a sound that we've often heard in the lodge. Remember, she's taken that cache into the lodge to eat it in the warmth, and she's trying to get down to the juicy bits underneath the bark. The loch froze over last night. One of the kits came out, probably after our programme finished, after 9 o'clock. Tries to get out on the ice, rather ungainly. And remember, it's only 7 months old. This is the first winter it's experienced ice, and it's obviously quite thin ice. You can hear it cracking. And then she decides it's going to give up trying to get out, and it dives down and swims underneath the ice.
That's amazing. That's a silver torpedo, Michaela. Look at that.
It really is, and that is an extraordinary shot to get. Now then, the second little kick comes out, does the same thing, struggles a bit, but this one perseveres a little more, and eventually, oops, falls in. As I say, you can hear the cracking ice, but perseveres again, up it goes, and it waddles off on the ice. Absolutely fabulous footage that we've got on our live cameras overnight. And a lot of you are watching that on Red Button.
Absolutely brilliant. Shall we go and see if we have live beavers? Let's go into our live cameras, have a little look. Oh, we have! That looks like, is that Mum again?
Or
is that
a kit?
It's a kit, smaller kit, emulating Mum, having another snack.
Much smaller twig.
Much smaller twig, yeah.
Look, it's trying to collect two twigs. Look how well they use their forepaws to carry things. It's got them both into its mouth, but
it's now
it's
it.
Dark.
No, can I say one thing? This is obviously in total darkness.
Oh, so, true. Very yeah, good point. Because it can't see what it's doing. That's nice. I think that's a cheesy stick, Chris. It's not a twig at all.
And look, it's taking this from its cache, probably, into the lodge to eat either now or later.
Yeah, let's see what it does. Those do look like they've had the bark removed, which they makes do. You wonder, why are they bringing twigs with no bark left on, where all the essential nutrients have gone, into the lodge? Look how delicately it's placing it, though. It's all very deliberate, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Now it's cleaning its teeth.
It's going to be very uncomfortable to sleep on, though, if they stay there. I'll just cover them up with a bit of straw.
Or maybe it's making its bed. Look.
What's it doing with that? Is it building?
It's building.
I think it's adding a bit of wood to the lodge, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's... Because they do that, don't they? They will continue sort of modify and extend the lodge. Look at that. I haven't seen that before.
Now, remember, these are nocturnal animals, and they will come to life at this time of night. They usually come out around this time, spend a little time on the loch, foraging, eating, going to the cache, building their dams, and then they'll come up. They might have a little doze before they go out again, and they'll spend all night out on the loch if it's mild, like a little bit milder tonight.
Look, we're about 4 or 5 minutes into the show. I promised you more zoological bravado. You've just seen it for the first time. A beaver kit reinforcing its lodge. Absolutely.
Can I just
fantastic.
Remind you that was live? Just behind us.
Let us go a little broader, shall we? Extend ourselves a little?
I think we should, yes.
Let us leave the beavers. Now, we noticed something very curious going close to us here. Look at that wintry scene. And those little specks down the bottom, that's a herd of red deer. We go a little bit closer now. What's happening? We've noticed they're coming down from the tops of the hills to the lower ground, and for a very, very good reason. They've got to feed. After the rut that we saw in Autumn Watch, the stags, it's make or break time for them. They must feed, and they're not able to get at the food higher up the hills, so we see them all coming down. Here's a couple of youngsters having a little tussle, maybe preparing themselves for next year's rut. But that's what they're doing. They're coming down off the hills so they can get much better food lower down in the valleys. Mm. Fascinating. Mm.
It's a good time
you were going to say something
well,
now.
Well, it's a good time of the year to see them in Scotland.
You were going to say something.
Yes, OK, I will tell you that this is almost unbelievable. Red deer can actually reduce their metabolism voluntarily. They can slow their heartbeat down, consciously slow their heartbeat down, so that they can conserve up to 17% more energy. Now, you don't think of that of a deer when you look
you
at them, do you,
no.
really? And it's obviously an essential survival strategy in winter. Saving energy means that you can make it last longer.
Now... Red deer are very, very good at surviving these harsh conditions, but there's another sort of deer quite close to here that takes the whole business of winter survival to a whole new level. Here, in the ancient Cairngorm Mountains, a lone voice is carried on the wind. It's a Scottish variation of a traditional Scandinavian refrain, calling in the reindeer from the hills.
On a blustery winter's day, I've come to meet Fiona Smith, a Scottish reindeer herder, whose family manage this free-roaming herd.
Right, Fiona, what do I do now?
I just finally got to the bag and grind, that's it. And the girls will come over.
So, Fiona, here we are surrounded by reindeer in Scotland. How did they get here?
Well, this herd was reintroduced, but reindeer are native to Scotland. Uh-huh. Many years ago died out. And they were reintroduced for the fact that this is where they should be. The Cairngorms being the only place they can still live naturally in Scotland. So that for them to be here, it is managed. But if we turned our back on them tomorrow, they would survive.
They'd survive out
Absolutely.
Here. They're perfectly adapted. Yep. Now, reindeer fur is very special. It's in two layers, a bit like me. I've got an outer layer and an inner layer. That's just what they've got. They've got an outer layer of longer guard hairs. Then underneath, they've got this sort of thick, downy layer, and you never, ever get down to the reindeer's skin. In fact, for them, the problem isn't keeping warm, it's keeping cool. So, Fiona, what other adaptations have they got to the extreme cold?
OK, everything about a reindeer is designed to keep them warm or to save energy. They're like a walking thermos, they are completely insulated. They've got their lovely beard, which comes down below their neck, should it rain during the day and freeze at night. It's freezing down here, not up right by their windpipe.
Right, that's neat.
Which is amazing. And then they've got these massive wide feet to spread their weight in the snow for digging. And you'll see when they walk that they'll put their back feet into exactly the same spot as their front, so they're only compressing the snow the once. Right.
Let's try and have a look at a closer look at a foot. Let's have a look. There we go. You can see the foot and the way that it all just splays out there. It's like a snowshoe. It really is. Quite thin. Very flexible.
So reindeer are built to withstand extreme temperatures. Even their noses are covered in velvety fur. But there's another reason they can thrive in the Cairngorms' Arctic conditions.
Even in the depths of winter, under feet of snow, reindeer can still find food, and they'll dig down to get at this stuff, lichen. Lichen's not terribly full of protein, but there's enough carbohydrate in it to keep the reindeer ticking over and keep them going throughout the winter.
Reindeer will graze over large distances, and keeping in touch with the rest of the herd is vital. But that can be difficult in extreme weather and low visibility. Evolution has provided another adaptation to tackle this problem.
Now, one thing you notice when you're amongst reindeer is this strange clicking sound. You hear that? Click, click, all the time. It sounds like they're treading on twigs or something. But they're not. It's a special device in their back feet. What's happening is a tendon is clicking across the bone in their back feet. And that clicking is a form of communication. So if it was snowing really hard and they're following each other along, heads down, they can hear the reindeer in front just listening for those clicks. They don't have to grunt, they don't have to do anything. They just follow the clicks. And they're clever.
Better still, by not communicating with grunts or calls, reindeers save heat. They really are superbly adapted for Britain's most extreme winter habitat.
So as far as you're concerned, the reindeer should be here in Scotland for the foreseeable future, really.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, they're sort of essential part
of
our Scottish wildlife. They're back, they're here to stay.
Now, what I find really interesting about reindeer is it's both the male and the females that grow antlers.
Yes.
However, the males drop theirs after the rut, which is late autumn, early winter. The females don't drop theirs until the spring after they've given birth, which means that it's only the females that have antlers on December the 24th and 25th, which means that Santa's reindeer are
all females.
Female.
They're all
Dasher,
cows.
Rudolph.
Badly named, weren't they?
Yes.
They were all badly named, because they should all be girls.
Females.
They should all be. But what's really fascinating is, why is that? Why do the males lose their antlers before the females? Here is a set of male reindeer antlers. They tend to be much bigger than the females. They also have this curious sort of axe-shaped bit at the front there, and they think that's for cutting through the snow to get to the lichen, help get to the lichen. Chiselling away. You can see that, how that might work. But what happens is that Generally, the males with their antlers are dominant over the females. But when they lose their antlers, the females then become dominant. Whoever's got the antlers is dominant. Why? The female needs food. She needs first dibs at the food because she's pregnant. So by having the antlers, it allows her to dominate the males, get first access to the food, and that helps her with her calf.
I always find that very interesting. Yeah. Now, of course, reindeer are perfectly adapted to live in the snow, but what about small mammals? How do they cope? Well, some of them surprisingly well, especially the ones that take full advantage of warm places. Just take a look at what arrived in the beaver lodge. It is a little water shrew.
Absolutely fascinating. Extremely rarely seen. It's our largest shrew. It's very dark on the back, white on the tummy. And when they swim in the water, which they do, they hunt in water, they look like a little silvery torpedo again, a little bit like that, because all the air sticks to their fur. But here is the fascinating thing. They're venomous. They're actually venomous. A very primitive sort of venom. There's venom in their saliva, and they have a little notch. It's called the venom groove in their tooth. And the venom just runs down that and partially paralyzes their prey.
But I wonder how the beaver would have reacted to the shrew. Interesting.
Any animal should be frightened of shrews. They're really tough.
Well, we had another shrew in our mammal stump, which has now been renamed by Chris Rodentorium. And this is a common shrew, and they have an amazing winter survival technique. Their skeleton shrinks, so they get smaller. I mean, as you can see, in that they're tiny anyway. They're almost the size of the hazelnut, 8 to 9 grams. They're absolutely weeny, but they're very aggressive. So I was wondering, if you had a common shrew in with a mouse, which one would you put your money on in the Rodentorium?
Top trumps. Do you know, my money would be on the shrew. But look at this. The shrew is absolutely minute. Look at it beside those nuts. It's absolutely tiny. But if we slide in a picture of the mouse, it's much, much bigger than mouse. That gives you a really useful comparison there.
But
the shrew is tiny.
Even bigger than that, we had an unexpected visitor in the Rodentorium. We teased you a little bit with this at the beginning of the programme. What could it possibly be? It is a pine marten. I mean, compared to the shrew and the mouse, it looks absolutely enormous.
It's huge. Isn't that an interesting comparison? A shrew's nothing compared to that. But here's the weird thing, Michaela. What is it eating in there? It seems to be coming in and out, taking out nuts. It looks like hazelnuts. And you think, well, wait a minute, a pine marten is a carnivore. What's it doing? And why is it not eating? It's taking them out. It's just sitting on the top with them. Could it be caching them? I kind of think of its teeth. The squirrel's perfectly adapted for opening a nut. I don't think a pine marten is. Shall we check in with the expert?
Well, let's ask Chris, because I don't know either. Chris, what do you think?
Well, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, pine marten's teeth, it's got those sharp incisors, some sharp, what we used to call carnassial teeth, for cutting the food, their meat, when they catch it. They haven't really got powerful jaws for cracking open a hazelnut. I think it's force of habit. It's caching things because it's found an abundance of food, and maybe that's what it thinks it's got to do. Now, they're also highly arboreal mammals, the pine marten. If you were watching earlier in the week, you knew that we'd set up some tests for them. Take a look at this. This is our pine marten feeding area. And there, hanging from a rope, is some tempting bait for the marten. Now, they have no trouble climbing up these vertical trunks. They've got very strong forelimbs, and then when it comes to going down, they've got these flexible ankles, which enable them to twist and turn and get down very easily. They've scoffed all the food on the ground at this stage. It's just late in the evening. So this one, look, it's sniffing about. It knows there's still some food there. It can smell it. And once again, remember, this is in total darkness. This is lit with infrared. But then it turns tightrope walker. Look at that. It's too easy, wasn't it, really? Walked out, balancing with its tail. And here it's reaching down and taking the bait that we put in there. And listen, hear it gobbling it up. And it soon returns. Watch the tail again. It's not only about keeping the animal warm when it's all curled up, it's about balance. And down it goes with consummate ease. Now, the reason I'm whispering is that I'm actually quite close to that pine marten feeding station where we've been baiting them since autumn watch. If we come just through here, this wall behind me runs up into the woods, and about 200 metres up through there is where that pine marten feeding station is. In fact, when the pine martens arrive, very often we see them on top of this very wall. Let's go live now to see if there's any activity there. There's the wall. I'm standing alongside the bottom part of. I don't think there's much showing. What we've done, though, look in the centre there. We've actually upped the ante, if you like, and we've made it slightly more difficult for the pine martens. They've got to reach down far further to get the food. Will they be brave enough? Will they have enough arboreal alacrity to reach it? Well, we'll have to find out later, because there are no pine martens there at the moment. And if you're wondering why they need to be such good climbers, they feed a lot on voles, particularly in the wintertime, and so do foxes. And we think that one reason that they climb so well is they want to avoid competition with those and find a different source of food. And this means that they can live in the same place as foxes at the same time. Bit of niche separation between species. Now, last night, if you were watching the programme, you might have been listening too. Julie Collins was pleased to point out that we were being somewhat upstaged by the call of a tawny owl. Well, Julie, we don't mind being upstaged by the wildlife. That's what we're here for. But we also saw the bird when the show had finished. Here it is out in the woods. And it's giving that characteristic quick contact call. And you can see it's got those bright eyes glowing there. That's a special layer of cells called the tapetum at the back of the eye, which reflects the light through the sensitive cells so it can see far more clearly. But what's all of this calling at this time of year all about? Because all over the UK, you can go out of an evening now and listen for tawny owls. Well, it's about territoriality, because the pairs of tawny owls are already in their territories and they're defending them from rivals at the moment. They breed very early in the year. And this is one of the calls that you might hear. Now, both the males and the females will make that ooh call. The females sound as if it's a bit more wailing, it's a bit more plaintive. But it's all about keeping rivals out, making sure you've got plenty of food for yourself in that territory so that you're ready to breed in the springtime. There are about 19,000 pairs all over the UK. And as I mentioned, as long as you've got a structured habitat, somewhere for them to perch so that they can look and listen for their prey, they could be near you, even if you're in the middle of a city. And, you know, we tend to think of our cities as being hostile places for wildlife where not much can survive. Well, take a look at this, because it's not the case. In the depths of winter, cities can seem particularly uninviting. In this stark, unnatural landscape, it's really hard to imagine what wildlife could actually thrive here. And yet, you know, there are animals here. And some of them are taking advantage of the urban world in very surprising ways. All these buildings and the relentless flow of traffic all produce heat. In fact, the very fabric of a city, the tarmac, the stone, all of that shining glass absorbs, reflects, and stores this heat. And believe it or not, this raises the temperature by up to 2 degrees compared to the surrounding countryside, and that's significant. You see, these extra few degrees of warmth can mean the difference between life and death for some animals, especially during long winter nights. For instance, pied wagtails are drawn into our towns to find shelter. In winter, hundreds can gather to roost. Of course, there is safety in numbers, but also, vitally, there's shared warmth. The trees that they roost in should have shed their leaves, but streetlights create artificial daylight, so the trees hang on to those leaves and use that light to generate their own energy. Next time you're out and about, look at the streetlights in your road and see if it's the case there. And these pied wagtails do seem to select the trees which have more leaf cover left. I suppose it makes sense. Protection from the wind, the elements, and of course, it will help keep them warm. As commuters are heading home, some of our city residents are just waking up.
and many of these are homing in on another benefit of city life, convenience food. On this housing estate, there's a very unexpected visitor. Fallow deer have come into town to feed on the green grass of our manicured lawns. This is a rich food source compared to the slim pickings of the winter woodlands. The long nights will give them more time to feed, but by the time the local human residents wake up, these shy animals will be long gone. Perhaps the best chance of noticing they've been there is to see some of their footprints in the lawn. Others, though, are also out searching for food, and there's absolutely loads here for those who can stomach a varied diet. Some animals take advantage of the places that people have neglected. Now, urban badgers, like their country cousins, like to build their sets on sloping ground with plenty of cover, and this clan have made their home on a railway embankment. They don't seem to mind the noise, and the barrier created by the tracks means that they can forage undisturbed by man. During the winter, these city badgers are doing exactly what their country cousins would be up to, gathering up warm bedding to get them through the cold winter nights. Now, you know, badgers inherit their sets, so this clan could have been living here since the tracks were laid 100 years ago. What I like about it is they found their own space in an increasingly crowded world. Our cities might be designed for humans, but so many animals have worked out how to take advantage of the urban landscape. And in winter, urban areas provide a lifeline for some of our more streetwise wildlife, helping them to get through the toughest time of the year.
Ceases to amaze me, actually, the variety of wildlife you can see in cities.
Amazing.
And I've been on some fabulous urban safaris. One of my favourites was in a graveyard in southwest London, mm-hmm. where the gravedigger was feeding foxes, and we got absolutely brilliant views of urban foxes.
My Uncle Sam lives in NW5, and he's got a graveyard near him, and he gets foxes all the time there. It's a top spot because they're generally quite quiet, and normally people don't take dogs into them,
yeah.
which scare the foxes away. Now then, what about a bit of urban bird watching? If I said to you, go and look for a bluebird, a checkered or a pied, what might I be suggesting? Well, this, pigeons. And in tomorrow's show, we get to grips with the pigeon. You see, it's not, as it's much perceived, a maligned bird. It's actually a very fascinating animal. Top film with an interesting bit of science to come.
Well, we've got some photos, actually, of people that have been doing a little bit of urban bird watching. Look at this. You're going to like this one, Chris.
Okay.
Look at this. Top bird, peregrine, on a very interesting sculpture there, sent in by someone called Green Man. Stunning, eh?
Yes, look at that. The peregrine's beautiful. I've got reservations about the sculpture, but never mind. That's a fabulous bird to see in the city centre.
And I've got another one to show you. This is going to really impress you. Let me show you the picture first.
Yeah.
This is from Michael Franklin.
It's beautiful.
It's a bearded tit. Now, that doesn't look unusual, but
well,
it is
gorgeous.
When I tell you, Chris, that was taken a couple of days ago in Hyde Park in London, and that's the first time ever they've been seen in inner London.
I'm not surprised. And that's a fabulous sighting. I bet lots of people went to see it. It's an amazing bird to see there, because normally they inhabit extensive reed beds in various parts of the country, and they don't seem to move very much unless the weather's tough. And because things are tough in East Anglia at the moment, lots of snow and ice, it might have been driven out of there and found its way along the Thames corridor and then into Hyde Park. What a find, though. You wouldn't believe it if you saw that.
One thing that you would believe seeing in parks is a squirrel, because they're often in our parks, the grey squirrel. But this is a great time of the year to look out for them, because they're pretty active. Around now, all the way through to March, the females are coming into season and the males start chasing them, not only around the park, but also up the trees. And it's something we've all seen and enjoyed.
And they make a lot of noise, so listen out for them barking. They make this curious barking sound. And sometimes it's not just one male that's chasing the female. You get a whole gang of them, up to five or six or seven of them, all chasing the female through the trees. Quite entertaining.
Now, we've been very lucky so far on the programme. We've had great live beavers, we've had pine martens, we've got cameras all over the place. One of the animals we've been looking at is the red squirrel. And I'm going to tell you a very interesting fact about red squirrels and Cinderella. stay with me. In the French version of Cinderella, yeah, she's wearing a Vair slipper. Mm-hmm. Vair
glass.
A glass.
Glass.
But Vair, V-A-I-R, also refers to the white soft fur of a red squirrel that was used for expensive clothes by the nobility. So it seems in the French version, Cinderella was not wearing a glass slipper, she was wearing a squirrel slipper.
This is a disaster. There's going to have to be a major reshoot by the Disney Corporation. She's got the wrong shoes on.
But I'll tell you something, it must have been an awful lot more comfortable than a glass slipper and a lot warmer. But how does a red squirrel keep warm? Well, I took a couple of hours off from rehearsals yesterday to find out.
There's not many opportunities during the live week of Winterwatch that I get a chance to sit down quietly and wait for something to happen. But if I'm going to have any chance of seeing these charming little characters, then that's exactly what I'm going to have to do. Now, they're up the tree at the moment. If I want to see them close up, I'm going to have to put some nuts down and be patient. Red squirrel right in front of me. My patience has paid off, and they are such cute little characters. One thing that really stands out are their little tufty ears. And at this time of the year, those ears are as fluffy as they're ever going to get. Not only do they look rather dashing, but they're very useful too. They use those tufty ears for communication.
By signalling with their ear tufts and tails, they send important messages to other squirrels. This is particularly important for their courtship and to work out who's the most dominant squirrel in a territory.
Now this morning, although it's cold up here in Agas, it's not freezing. And so these little guys are quite active. Once the temperatures really drop and there's snow on the ground, they become a lot less active. In fact, they do what a lot of people do. They stay in bed. Quite sensible, really.
Red squirrels have numerous nests, known as drays, which protect them from the harsh weather. With up to 7 centimetres of cosy lining, these small homes can be up to 30 degrees warmer on the inside.
You know, I've always loved squirrels. To me, it doesn't matter whether I'm watching grey ones or red ones. They're always very endearing and entertaining to watch. And for me, that certainly was a great way to spend an hour.
Ah, oh, come on, Chris, red squirrels. They're a beautiful little creature.
They are, yes, they are, but they're not a pine martin.
Now, you may remember, we set those very red squirrels a challenge, and credit where credit's due, this experiment was designed by my colleague, Professor Packham here. Let's just remind ourselves what we did.
We set three different possible food sources for the squirrels, some raisins, some shelled hazelnuts, and some hazelnuts still in their shells. And we discovered that the squirrel took the hazelnuts that were still inside their shells. And we thought the reason for that was he looked quite full, he didn't want the food immediately, he was taking those nuts off to cache them, to bury them, and he needed the shells to protect the nut to stop it rotting.
Mm-hmm. They solved that little riddle, and they took the right one. But, you know, these squirrels are out there, swinging around the trees like a bunch of Tarzans. Nuts is what they should be after. So we offered them a different set of choices. We knew that they wanted nuts in their shells, but now we've offered them three types of nut in their shell. We've got almonds on the left, we've got walnuts in the centre, and we've got hazelnuts on the other side, all perfectly ready, packaged, to be cached by the squirrel. Now, initially, it thinks, look, it's my lucky day. I've got a lovely big walnut, but it just can't fit it in its mouth. It keeps dropping it.
Oops.
So it gives up and goes for hazelnuts. It's copped out. But then it thinks, oh, I'll give it another go. I'll give it another go. Look at this. I must take advantage of this bonanza. So it caches it in amongst the hazelnuts. Then it comes back, and effectively, it just dumps the walnut after a nice little try and goes back to the hazelnuts. Now, this is interesting, Martin, because you would think that if it could carry away one of those larger walnuts, it would make sense.
Yeah.
They're about four times the weight of the hazelnut, so when it returned to it, it would have four times the value. But perhaps it's too heavy or too inconvenient for it to carry away. That's what's leading to its choice. So when it comes to optimal foraging, it's not always about the energy, it's about the ease of what you've got to achieve. But rest assured, I've got another experiment planned for our squirrels tomorrow, one that they will... Well, I think they'll solve it. It's whether we can, to be truthful with you. Now, at the beginning of the programme, we set you a little quiz. I ask you which feather... which bird this feather had come from. Winter visitor to the UK. It's a tail feather. And it's a tail feather to a bird that comes to our shores. Has anyone got it right, Martin?
No, we've got... Everyone's been coming in. Answer: Steve Black thinks it's a black grouse. A bit thin. Richard Sermon thinks it's an Arctic tern. And Jan Bridge thinks it might be a swallow.
No, no.
Not a swallow.
Winter visitor.
Winter visitor.
Beautiful.
Winter visitor. Keep them coming in. Now, for many of us, the wildlife that we see most often are the birds in our back garden on the feeders. Certainly, that's what I see. But look closely, and there's quite a bit of a hierarchy going on here. Now, here's our little coal tit on there. They're quite feisty, and although they're small, they will see off other birds. Here's a coal tit. But generally, the bigger birds see off the smaller birds. Well, now, here's a siskin. Now, they are a bit feisty, aren't they, Chris? They will... They're not a very pleasant bird, are they?
They can be really aggressive for a small bird. Yeah. Really aggressive.
Little blue tit generally will give way to the great tit above it. And look at this. The chaffinch comes in, beating its wings. The great tit thinks, discretion is the better part of valour. I'm off. And off he goes.
Hung on to the last minute, though, didn't
he? He did. Yeah, he wasn't going to go. Sometimes they stay off. They're really, really hungry. Now, you'll often see birds like this chaffinch. They'll hang around, particularly when the big guy, the woodpecker, comes in. They'll sit in the bushes around, won't they? But no one will come in when the woodpecker's there.
No one misses with a great spot.
The greatest spotted woodpecker.
Another bird that we saw in close proximity to our feeder with this flock of birds was the tree creeper. Now, they don't visit those sorts of feeders. These are insectivorous birds, and as you can see, it's climbing up the trunk here and here probing in amongst the lichen to find its food. So why is it with the other birds? Well, this is part of a phenomena we call mixed species flocking. And very often you might be walking in the winter woods and it's very quiet. There's nothing around at all. Then all of a sudden, a huge horde of birds will come around you. It could be tits, finches, thrushes, nuthatches and tree creepers. Well, they are together deliberately. Because if they're together, they've got more eyes looking out for predators, and they will give alarm calls, some of them, particularly the thrushes, and they all have very similar alarm calls, so they're recognised by other species. Why is it such a benefit? Well, scientists looked at the tree creeper, and they found that when they were in flocks of five, they pecked for food five times a minute. But when they were in flocks of up to 30 birds, the number of pecks per minute, the amount of food they could find, went up to 40. So they find more food if they're in a flock with more birds, because then they can spend more time looking for it and not looking out for predators because all the other birds are. What about that? That's pretty cool.
I think it's amazing. I think it's astonishing that all that mixed flock, the birds start to speak the same language. They recognise each other's alarm calls.
They certainly do. Now, sometimes I think we underrate birds to some extent. Perhaps a humble little tree creeper there might be overlooked. And there's another species which I think is a candidate for this. So I went up the hill the other day to get a closer view of them. The coaltit, in my opinion, one of our most underrated and underloved birds. They are one of the UK's great success stories. Since the 1970s, their numbers could have increased by as much as 63%. And what's the key to that success? Well, basically, it's a lot more coniferous woodlands, because these birds really are a pine tree specialist, particularly spruce trees. And post-war, we planted lots of these. Now they've come to maturity, producing lots of cones, and therefore lots of seeds for the coaltits. And they don't move far, and we get very few birds coming over from the continent. So all of the coaltits that you see in your garden are probably birds which have nested very local to you. They do really well in the winter. Their survival rates are pretty high unless it's a very, very cold winter. And there are a couple of reasons for this. Firstly, they can forage on the undersides of branches. So if it snows, they're not picking through the snow, they're hanging beneath the branch where there isn't any, and they're able to find their food. The second thing is that they cache food throughout the autumn and early winter, and now they're taking advantage of that, going out and finding it to get through those tough, cold nights. They might be doing quite well in terms of their numbers, and their winter survival might be good, but they always need a helping hand. So make sure your feed is topped up for these underrated little chaps.
Like a coaltit?
I like a coaltit, and honestly, I do think when they're really hungry, they will see off other birds, off my feeders.
Feisty?
They're feisty, yeah, I like them very much. They're not sharp and nasty like a siskin.
No.
There's something generous about them, deep down. Sorry, let's move on. Now, when you're watching your feeder, all the different tits are coming in, and sometimes in that great flurry, it's difficult to tell one from another. So let us have now the Winterwatch Guide to Tits. Here's the blue tit. Most people know that. The great tit, considerably bigger, more black. Now, here they all are together. The great tit's got the black cap on the top, blue cap for the blue tit, and that white stripe on the coal tit down towards the bottom of the feeder. Good shot, get them all there. So here's the great tit. The male has got a broader black stripe down the chest and that black head. And here we have the coal tit. There's no stripe on it at all. You just see that little bit of white on the back of the head. And here's the blue tit. It's got the yellow chest and obviously that blue cap. And fascinatingly, they see in a different colour spectrum to us, and that blue to them glows, doesn't it?
It does.
Looks different from tit to tit.
In fact, it's how they identify different individuals. They've got different head patterns. That's how males recognise one another.
Absolutely beautiful.
Of course, we haven't just been hanging around the feeders recording birds. We've been much further afield, up onto the tops where there's been a bit of snow. And here's a species which typically we see in autumn when it's displaying, and of course, it's a very famous bird.
It certainly is. Look at that beautiful red grouse. Struggling there in the snow a bit, Chris.
Yeah, they are struggling because they like to feed on heather shoots, and here all of the heather has been smothered. So they found just this little ridge here, look, where the snow's blown off, and they are furtively pecking and picking as quickly as possible to try and get as much of those heather shoots as they possibly can. But they will move down considerably lower in the winter. If it does snow, they move lower down off of the hill.
Right. Now, of course, they're very, very similar, those red grouse, to the ptarmigan that we looked at earlier on in the show. But the ptarmigan have a different strategy for feeding. At first sight, you might think it's pretty much the same. But here they are, they will feed on much lower food. Here it is pecking away at moss. They'll eat blaberry and crowberry as well, which are much lower down in the vegetation, not the heather that the red grouse are feeding on. Look how beautifully camouflaged they are there. So this is a great example, even though they're living in a very similar area, it's again niche separation, isn't it, Chris? We've already spoken about that tonight.
Niche separation, and it's altitude. They're higher, altitude. Grouse are lower.
Grouse are lower.
Certainly are. Now, one habitat, which is incredibly important in our winters, is fresh water. And rivers, as long as they keep running, are a perfect source for that.
Dartmoor, an ancient and unforgiving landscape, yet enigmatically beautiful in the depths of winter. This seemingly barren place is the source of a vital lifeline. The River Dart. Many animals on the moor need regular fresh water. Red deer will drink at the streams and graze on the grassy lawns at their edges. But up here in winter, this vital resource can be locked away, frozen for days on end. Winter sun eases the icy grip of short days and cold nights, and the Dart's peaty, nutrient-rich water is released, starting its 52-mile journey from source to sea. Trickles join into streams, and fresh water brings life to a wintry world. Dippers stay on the river all year round. Dense feathers insulate against the cold water as it hunts for small larvae like caddisfly and mayfly nymphs that become more plentiful in winter. This abundant food source allows dippers to be one of the earliest breeding birds, and many will be building or repairing their nests now. Grey wagtails like fast-running streams too, but they're more cautious, foraging at the stream's edge for any insects that are washed up. Kingfishers depend on water to hunt, and in winter they will move downriver towards the sea if inland waters are frozen. The waters from Dartmoor flow stronger and bolder from east and west, merging at Dartmeet. Now one big river, the Dart flows south, getting deeper and broader, and leaving the moorland and woodland behind. Twelve miles inland from the sea, fresh water meets salt. Home to ragworms and other food for wading birds like redshank. The Dart estuary shelters a nursery for sea bass and other fish, which in turn attract herons and cormorants to hunt. The journey of the Dart is over. All the way from moor to sea, its nutrient-rich fresh water is a lifeline for a whole host of plants and animals in the hard times of winter.
And you can't underestimate that. Lifeline is the word. Fresh water is incredibly important for all sorts of things. Birds, things like herons and bitterns and kingfishers, if it freezes, they have to head to the coast, and it's not optimal foraging habitat for them. It's marginal and they don't do as well. And one other thing that's worth pointing out is, you know, if you do have birds coming to your garden, you're feeding them and it's frozen, make sure they get plenty of fresh water. Provide it throughout the course of the day so they can both drink and bathe.
And if you have a pond in your garden, then try and stop it freezing over, because it will be an absolute oasis for wildlife. Someone that did just that was Kevin Loder from Cambridgeshire, and he had some spectacular results. Have a look. He filmed this, and look at the amount of birds coming to that pond. Not only drinking, but bathing as well. And you can see he's stopped the ice from freezing over. So that just proves that it's a really good idea to do it. Thank you so much for that, Kevin. But you know, one way to stop your pond from freezing over is put a ball in the middle of it. And as the ball moves around, as long as it doesn't get too cold, and then you can stop the ice.
If it's windy, the ball will blow around. If it's not windy, the ball will just sit there and freeze.
Frogs will play a bit of football, you know what I mean?
Fair enough, fair enough.
Now, yesterday we were talking not entirely about water freezing, but also about water flooding. And we've had some questions. What happens to all the freshwater fish in the floods? Where do they go? And that's from Rob Jan.
Well, they can get stranded a long way from the original watercourse, the river or stream where they live. And obviously some birds will take advantage of this. I've seen herons feeding on fish in pools that have had originated from rivers. And other people have reported kingfishers doing the same. So initially it's a bonanza for other animals, but ultimately it's bad news for the fish.
Have we got any answers for the quiz? I think we have, actually.
Yes, the
quiz. What is this feather? Where is it from? Sue McMillan, glossy ibis.
No.
We had beech mice, someone called beech mice. Is it the entail from a tern?
No.
David Tufts, black-tailed godwit.
Oh, I wish.
Is it, says Mary Skipper, Dominic, William Bell and Gail, a long-tailed duck?
It certainly is. Look at this. All 20 centimetres, this particular feather of a long-tailed duck. A pretty special bird. And I was very lucky to pop down to the coast earlier to see these things in the flesh.
Sea ducks migrate from the Arctic during winter. And they spend most of their time out at sea. But today, I'm really lucky, because an onshore wind has blown these eiders much closer to land, and this is giving me an ideal opportunity to get close to these remarkable birds.
The drake eider is a spectacular bird in its breeding plumage. Just look at this. It's got that peachy wash on its chest, those lovely green panels over the back of its head, and very neat black lines. It really is dressed up in a fabulous uniform. But I've got to tell you, it pales into insignificance compared to a bird that's just round the corner. Look at that. There can be few finer birds that visit the UK during winter than this drake long-tailed duck. I've never, ever been this close. I've seen them, but they're always right out at sea. This is about 6, 7, 8 metres away on a flat, calm harbour. Absolutely sensational. Look at the crisp colouring, those beautiful white scapulars, shoulder feathers, and then that long, thin tail, 30 centimetres of long-tailed duck. And it's so close that I can see the little cream ring around the eye. It's truly exquisite. It really is. And when they dive, they do this thing where they slightly open their wings, throw their head back, and then topple into the water. They're diving down like this to find their food, which is typically mollusk, a few crustaceans, even small fish. The thing is that they'll dive into quite deep water, up to 60 metres, which means that when they're wintering here, they can be so far offshore that they're difficult to see, difficult to count. So we're not entirely sure how many there are here in winter in Scotland. We think around 15,000. Thankfully, they're now doing some aerial surveys, so we might have a better idea. Oh my goodness, look at that. I don't believe it. There's another drake with two females has joined them. There's going to be a confluence here, a confluence of four long-tailed ducks about 10 metres away from me. Oh, look at that. What an assemblage. I'm not sure where those other three came from. There's two drakes now and two females right in front of me. This is ornithological nirvana. Beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. This is a lifetime moment, I can tell you. Oh, I'm going to need to sit down, calm down. Sometimes nature just gets it right, doesn't it? I mean, it really is just about the perfect bird. I make no apologies for being totally love-struck. What a bird. What a bird.
Fantastic birds. There's something very curious you might have noticed about some of those sea ducks, particularly those lovely long-tailed ducks. They're kind of black and white. Nearly all the males are black and white. Now, why might that be, black and white? Here's a clue. Look at this picture. Now, why is that a clue? Well, they used to use black and white as camouflage for battleships. And what we think is that the black and white of male sea ducks does act as camouflage. Well, here's another one.
Belfast.
Belfast, HMS Belfast, lovely. It is in actually black and white, so it's it could be pink and green, couldn't it, for all we know. But just to see whether you think that that camouflage actually works, just watch this. Here's the long-tailed duck again, and the colours very similar to the rippling on the water.
I thought it was a battleship, actually. I was so confused.
That's how good it is.
Can I tell you that a fellow called John Graham Kerr advised Churchill in 1917. He was a zoologist, this Graham Kerr bloke, and he advised Churchill to paint the battleships in what he called dazzle camouflage, and it caught on, and they continued to paint them that way. They first started in 1917.
Absolutely astonishing. Nature gets her first again.
Fantastic. I'm going to go from battleships to tap-dancing gulls.
Oh, I like that.
Seriously, have a look at this. This was actually filmed on a mobile phone by our executive producer, Tim Schoons, and there's the gull dancing away on the grass.
Extraordinary. It's
What's it doing?
It's trying to get vibrations to go through the soil, and it's treading or paddling to bring earthworms to the surface. And it's a behaviour you'll see in lots of other species too. Plovers will do this. Snipe will do it. Even woodcock, sneaking through the woods in the dark, will tremble with their feet as they put their feet forward. They'll tread like this to stimulate worms to come to the surface so that they can get them. And it's highly effective.
But they do exactly the same thing in shallow water, don't they?
You often see
them in shallow water, sort of stirring up crustaceans as well.
Oh, yeah, they're stirring rather than
stimulating. Should we have a look at our live cameras? Because the beaver's still in the lodge, and it'll be nice to finish on our live beavers. Now, we've seen a lot of this during the show. We saw it at the beginning of the show, so it's nice to end the show with a bit of live beaver action. And it's actually, I wonder, has it been doing that the whole programme, or has it been out of the lodge? Certainly back in there with a nice big twig, gnawing away. Let's see if we can hear it. We can. And who knows how long it's going to be doing that. You, of course, can be keeping your eye on the live cameras on the web and also on the red button overnight.
We've had a few photos sent in. Look at this one.
Oh,
it's very nice. Grey squirrel in the snow, taken a couple of days ago. This was Bojangle 72. And then what about this one?
That's
I'm afraid
gorgeous.
Bojangles, because it was a grey squirrel, this one tops it. This one was taken by Glesgastev. I don't know where that name came from. I made it
lovely
sound Russian.
Lovely picture, though.
But this is a fabulous picture of a sparrowhawk.
Gorgeous.
What a bird. Now, if the long-tailed duck was 7.9, this has to be an 8-male sparrowhawk.
Well, talking of 8, we're back tomorrow at 8 o'clock. That's the end of the programme. Lots coming up tomorrow. What have we got?
We've got ice and snow. How wildlife copes in the ice and snow.
And we're going to go back with Richard Taylor-Jones, and we're going to go and have a look at those seals again down in Norfolk.
So the main programme will be here at 8, and we've got Winter Watch Unsprung at 9 o'clock. Who knows, there'll be probably synchronised swimming beavers. See you tomorrow. Bye-bye.